Hello, happy Friday, everyone. Today is Friday, February the 27th, and I'm Marlo Artis, and you're listening to iTEACH, the Tario Teachers Radio Show, right here on BroncoRadio.com, where every second of the day an artist is live. Oh, go ahead, Arisha. I'm sorry, I jumped right in. I was ready to get started.
It's okay. This is the home of the second annual I Inspire Showcase Concert, featuring the 39th anniversary celebration of the FSU Gospel Choir on February 28th at 6 p.m. in the Seabrook Auditorium. You are listening to iTEACH.
Yay, this is iTEACH. I jumped the gun. It's not the first time I've jumped the gun. Yes, okay. iTEACH, the Tario Teachers Radio Show, is a tight-knit ensemble, and I'm happily joined by an incredible selection of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. So we'll start the roll call to my right. You heard a voice a few seconds ago.
Hello, everybody. I am Arisha Smalls, and I will be representing middle school.
Hi, I'm Cassandra Parsons, and I'll be representing special education.
Good evening. Happy Friday. I'm Dia Collins, representing the high school population.
Now, today is Focal Friday, and during these special broadcasts, we'd like to highlight educational leadership, as well as building a capacity to lead. And join us for these special broadcasts, and we had a great time with them last month, is Tom Hatch, our administrative designee. He's the principal of Reed Ross. How are you?
I'm good. How are you doing?
We're so glad that you decided to come out. I'm doing great. But wasn't that a great show that we had last time with Tom?
It was.
Yeah. It was such really a great. Natural.
Very natural. He just comes on the scene. It's like he's been doing this. Like you're here every single week. It's like your spirit joins us.
Oh, thank you. I enjoy it. You guys are good company.
Yes, we're so glad. Now, at the top of each broadcast, we like to dissect what we like to call the top educational topics of the week. And these topics are all, like I said, related to educational leadership this time because this is our Focal Friday. Now, if any of you want to join our conversation, please do go to our Facebook page, Tar Heel Teachers. And actually, I've got to pull up Facebook because we actually got a comment from a viewer who tuned in on and wanted to talk about our first topic. And I want to make sure that we highlight what she shared. So, Dia, go ahead and get us started with our first topic.
Okay. We are going to talk about the state of Florida suspending more students than any other state. And naturally, those of you that listen, you know I'm the data person. Right now, or as of this article, North Dakota suspends about 3% of their students in secondary education, whereas Florida is suspending 19% of their secondary students. You know, we learn something new every day. As a result of these suspensions, in the 2011-2012 school year, 3.5 million students were suspended. So that's a lot of students being suspended, and it is equivalent to losing 18 million days of instruction.
Oh my gosh.
What do you all think about that?
That's terrible. You actually look at the numbers like that, that's awful.
I think it switches from state to state. This is, as long as I've been in education, this is an ongoing problem with the suspensions. And I think from maybe year to year, it might vary a little bit, but the main thing are the young African American students.
Yeah, that's, and they did talk about that in the article. And they talked about how the secondary schools, actually, their percentage rate, you know, of suspensions is higher than elementary school. Which, I mean, that's a good thing. Could you imagine elementary schools suspending more than high schools?
Well, it talked about more about the zero tolerance that a lot of our secondary schools employ. And so that's why they said it was actually such a high number. But I wanted to highlight what our viewer actually said, or our listener. Her name is Nikki Barton. I believe she's in education. She says, suspension rates among African American students are high. However, you have a higher rate of insubordination with this group. When you don't suspend the students, they gain a sense of entitlement and feel they are untouchable. This also makes managing the classroom unbearable. If you don't suspend, then you have a classroom full of chaos. It's time to get parents involved and have some real conversations.
Oh, there it is, mm-hmm. Right there. It's the parents. It's not the parents' fault. It's not the child's fault. It's not the teacher's fault. It's nobody's fault because nobody wants to point a finger.
Yeah.
But somewhere you got to start.
Right.
And you know, as a parent of two teenagers, both in high school, it can be tough. Parenting is not an easy thing, and there's no handbook that came with the two children. You're kind of figuring this thing out on your own, and you know, there's a lot of things that happen at home that may be okay at home, but when you get to school, it's not okay. And unfortunately, as an administrator, you know, we don't have a lot of consequences that we can use, but I think our county does a great job in working with students, in helping our administrators really understand that, you know, just don't send them on out the door for the first offense.
Right.
You know, we've got to answer the question, why? Mm-hmm. Why is a kid doing what they're doing? And then once you can start figuring out why, then you can really begin to start working with a child and their family. It doesn't mean there won't be some consequences, but if you can figure out why a kid is doing something, then the next time something comes along, you see it brewing, maybe you can head it off. Maybe the teacher can head it off. They can prevent it from happening. We utilize our in-school suspension as a way, obviously, to keep kids from going home, mm-hmm. And help them better understand what it is that they've done wrong so that they don't do it again. But, you know, sometimes the person that made the comment there, you know, sometimes the infraction's bad enough that they can't be at school.
Yeah.
So I have a question, Tom. So you're saying you utilize in-school suspension, but does that not count in your numbers for suspension? Like, does this data not include in-school suspension?
I would take this, as I'm looking at it, as out-of-school suspension.
I think it is out-of-school suspension.
OSS.
Imagine if we calculate those in-school suspension numbers, how much class time is being missed.
That's right. But even about asking why, I heard you say if more principals would ask why and the teachers need to head it off, I think if teachers would ask why and not just automatically go to the frustration point to send kids out of the room where administration has to handle it. Some things we have to handle in our room, we just have to be more patient. No, we can't handle every single thing that happens, but I think a lot of things that cause students to get sent out, if teachers were just a little bit more patient and more diligent about really helping the child,
right,
we could...
And sometimes the way the teacher manages the class, it causes those things to happen, and the child acts out at the teacher or at a classmate, and then sometimes it's just the way the class environment is being handled and managed, and it just doesn't lend it, mismanaged, and it just doesn't lend itself to a supportive environment. So it's up to the administrator to help those folks to better understand ways to manage class and connect with their kids.
I think another thing to look at is repeat offenders. And some personalities just don't go together. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so if this child, you know, if the teacher has tried A, B, C, and D, you know, and the child keeps getting sent out for whatever reason, then that's another thing that we have to look at, you know. It seems like to me most of the teachers are doing their best to be patient and help these kids, but they have a lot of pressure as far as the content and teaching and responsibility of the 29 other students in that classroom. So am I going to allow this behavior to take away my teaching time, or am I going to stop and correct this behavior, or am I going to use what the school has, which is ISS, so that I can get through to these 29 other students that want to learn?
But I think, too, it goes back to what we say just about every week. And when you first came, we talk about building relationships. So if we harp on let the teachers build the relationships with the kids, then you have less discipline in the classroom.
Right.
So then we don't have to worry about suspending or putting them in ISS. They're going to perform for you when they know that you care.
But there also, another thing I want to highlight from this article, there is a, what they call it, a discipline gap between the races. They said African Americans were suspended at 6%. 6% of African Americans were suspended in 1972. Now in 2011, that rose to 16%, so that's a 10% increase. Whereas white students were suspended at 3% in 1972 and then 5% in 2011. So that's still such a low percentage. So that was another part of the article. And it said that students with disabilities are also suspended at a higher rate. Are you talking about those kids who have those behavioral issues? I mean, some kids have things that their doctor says they can't control.
And I was going to point that statistic out too about the disabilities. And what kind of disabilities are they including? Are they saying physical disabilities? Are they saying learning disabilities?
No, it's not physical.
Or all disabilities? I mean, but what are they?
Well, whenever you have disabilities, a child it doesn't matter. So if you've got a learning disability, you got autism, OHI, severe emotional disability, that's a child that's got an exceptionality. It's classified by EC services. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't matter what it is, if it's academic or if it's behavioral, it's still a child with disability. So any one of those categories,
this statistic is all disabilities?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's just like our grading of schools. You've got to look closely at it, because if you have some kids that are already classified as behavioral problems, of course their rates are going to be higher, even though the principals only have that cap of how many days that they actually can suspend them throughout the school year.
10 days. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
And we could talk about it forever because it's so many different things. And also look at the numbers. So the article is posted on our Facebook page. So go right on Facebook page, and also it'll be posted on the blog. So feel free to share your comments. The next thing that we want to talk about, Cassandra, was the... Where is it?
The police chief.
Over-policing contributes to high dropout rate. Over-policing.
Mm-hmm.
That's like targeting to me. I was looking at the article today, and I, matter of fact, I was sitting by our SRO officer today at lunch.
Mm-hmm.
And this one says, this is in Texas, and said he believes his colleagues contribute to increased high school dropout rates and reinforce the school-to-prison pipeline when they, rather than school administrators, discipline students for misbehaving.
But let's start right there for a second.
Mm-hmm.
Is that going on in schools where sometimes the SRO is handling things that should be handled by administration?
It shouldn't be.
You said it shouldn't be. Right?
It should not be.
Yeah, because I know I thought our SRO at our school was told to do discipline. He's like, no, I'm not allowed to do that. That's for administration. So when I read this article, I'm like, what in the world? And they even said that the police officers could charge the students with Class C misdemeanors for chewing gum in class.
What?
I'm like, what in the world?
But some of it, though, I'm sorry, some of it goes back to the teacher. You should not, under any circumstances, call the SRO. You should say, I'm calling the deputy. The administrator will make the decision if the deputy needs to be involved or not.
Right.
You let administration make that decision.
That's exactly what our school resource officer, is exactly a resource.
Mm-hmm.
It's capitalized on the R in that they're there as a resource to educate our children, work with them in various grade levels. They do all kinds of the GREAT program, and they talk about gang resistance education, and you know, and then they're just there as a resource to parents. Parents have questions, they've got concerns, some things happen. They can sort of give that insight. If this happens, then that can happen. But really, when it comes right down to it, unless a law has been broken and it's a reportable offense that has to go through Bruce Morrison's office and the sheriff's office, that sheriff is on the campus as a resource. They're not there to manage. They're not there to send kids home. They're not there to put kids in ISS or OSS or whatever.
They're not disciplinarians.
No.
And I think they should be there to build those relationships with the students.
There it is again, but relationships.
Yeah. Right, there it is again. That's the R word. But I have witnessed some of the officers being asked to step in, and I think a sad part of this is teachers are using that as leverage because they know, you know, not all the time, but if you think about some of our children that we serve in the neighborhoods they live in, then there's probably more police, you know, around the area. So they know the students are more familiar with things that go on, and they would use that as a leverage. So in order to, instead of using classroom management, they'll use that SRO officer and say, if you do so-and-so, then I'm just going to send you to him. He's not the disciplinarian.
But guess what? That's the same thing that administrators tell teachers. Do not use me as a scapegoat and say, I'm going to send you to the office. Then you've given away your power, and now the administrator is the one holding the cards. Administrators don't need to do the same thing a teacher shouldn't do and give all the power to the deputy, because at the end of the day, the deputy may be assigned to another school, may get a promotion, and you're still there, and you're going to have to manage your school and manage your classrooms.
But what about when the deputy takes things into their own hands? Because I've had an experience where... But I'm just saying, but they didn't get fired. But I'm saying, you know, they get a school walkie-talkie also. Mm-hmm. But if a call is made over the walkie-talkie for an administrator or assistants in a room, sometimes the deputy, I'm not saying at the current school that I'm at, I'm just saying I've had a past experience that the deputy will respond to the call and take the kids out before an administrator can even get there.
But you know what, another thing that we have to talk about too are safe schools coordinators. They are not administrators, so you have to make sure that there's a clear distinction, and it's the administrator's job to let those people know there are boundaries and you don't cross certain boundaries because you haven't had the proper training. Administrators have gone through extensive training on how to manage schools and behaviors, and they also know about disabilities. There's a lot of things that if you're not an educator, you don't know.
Right.
But one thing in the article that I really want to highlight, it says that one of the chief positions of a school resource officer is to regularly interact with students as positive mentors and trustworthy figures. Mm-hmm. Everything shouldn't be negative that you're going to the deputy or the deputy's going to deal with mm-hmm. you, because it should be, let's develop these positive relationships so they don't have this fear of the police.
And mm-hmm. to maintain safety for the faculty and the staff.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right. Not used. But I've seen the same thing, Arisha, and yes, he was fired.
And Arisha, speaking of maintaining safety, there was a safety issue in Oregon.
Yes, at Forest Grove. So the kids were being released. It was at dismissal, and a stranger just walked into the building. He was 29 years old. He walked into a classroom of third graders, and he picked up a student.
He just picked him up.
And the article doesn't go into exactly what he was saying, but whatever it was, the principal said that he really believed what he was saying. He seemed high or drunk, were the words that she used. Mm-hmm. But she was able to talk him down, and they got him out of the building, but she's taken some measures to make sure that incidences like this won't happen again.
And the police did capture him.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, those measures, I mean, she did what she thought was best in the safety of her children, but the measures to go outside the building, outside of her realm of safety, well, y'all think about that, because I've seen principals chase children into the woods, but this guy, we don't know what was waiting outside of the building, so what do you think about her leaving?
I put all that stuff aside. I'm going to protect my faculty, my staff, and my kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a situation, I'm not going into all the details, but I had a situation where somebody was on the campus, and I got on my cell phone, and I began to follow the guy, and I was on 911. And so I'm on the phone following this person. I ended up following him through the neighborhood because of what the guy had and what he was doing. It was just not right. And finally, the police showed up and apprehended the guy, and it was a whole big mess. But the guy started out on my campus, and I still had kids on the campus. You got to look out for your children and your teachers.
Safety first.
Male, female, would that make a difference?
This was a big guy I was walking after.
She was female.
Well, but she did say, she said that one of her assistants, who was a male, went with her.
Right.
So at least she had
some protection. Right.
Yeah, but it was an instructional assistant. Yes. Well, you got to take precautions. And that also proves, though, what our administrators deal with. There's so many different pieces to being an administrator, and they get a lot of flack, but it's not an easy job because it has so many different responsibilities. You're responsible for everybody in that building, from the cafeteria, the custodians, the school bus drivers, the students, the teachers, I mean, office staff. It's a big responsibility.
And I'm hoping our teachers are really trained about, because that can happen in the drop of a hat. You look up and somebody's in your room grabbing a student, so, you know, what do we do?
Right.
Like, she was able to talk him down, but that's...
But what we've got to do now is we have to take a break. Let's take a quick break. When we return, we'll be joined by Amanda O'Brien. She's coming from Terry Stanford High School, and she's here to talk about her project with the Governance Teacher Network. You're listening to iTeach, the Tar Heel Teachers Radio Show, right here on BroncoIRadio.com, where every second of the day
an artist is live.
Today is February the 27th. Happy Friday to everyone. We are so fortunate that because joined us in the studio, Arisha, oh my God.
You just don't want me to say my piece.
Say your piece.
You are listening to BroncoIRadio.com, where every second of the day an artist is live. And we are the home of the second annual I Inspire Showcase concert featuring the 39th anniversary celebration of the FSU Gospel Choir on February 28th at 6 p.m. in the Seabrook Auditorium. You are listening to I Teach.
That's going to be such a great concert. I'm really hoping that I have a chance to go. And everybody who's listening, if you haven't got your tickets, please make sure that you can pay at the door.
Yes.
You can pay at the door. So if you haven't purchased tickets already, meet me at the door and I'll see you there. Today is Friday, February 27th. And I was so excited because the person who's about to join us, she's such a great individual. And I was just so eager to start this conversation. We have Amanda O'Brien in the studio. And she's from Terry Stanford. She's one of the U.S. history teachers. And she's also a member of North Carolina's Governor's Teacher Network.
Hi, Amanda.
How are you doing?
Thanks for having me.
Well, we're so glad to have you. So let's go ahead and jump in and chime in. What are you working on with GTN?
So my topic was engagement for social studies. So what I wanted to look at was what instructional strategies can teachers use that will actually engage their kids.
Did you use some of those strategies over the last couple of days since we had all this snow? Did you use some of these instructional strategies?
I've been using these nonstop for about the last year and a half. Once I got onto them, I never left them. But I think a lot of times, you know, teachers, if the kids are just seated and quiet, they think, well, yes, they're engaged, but that's just behavior. They might not be following anything that you're talking about. Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to look for strategies. When you look at what the research says, there's different types of engagement. So there's behavioral engagement. There's emotional engagement. So like the connection students feel either with the material or with their classroom environment. Hmm. And then there's cognitive engagement, which is basically their willingness to try and put an effort forward. So I wanted to look at different strategies and see which strategies engage kids the most on the different types. And because I teach honors and standard kids, I wanted to look at the differences between those two levels and see if there was some strategies that worked better with one group of kids over another group of kids.
Tell us about these strategies. I'm intrigued.
So there are five total. So I teach, like you said, American history, social studies. So the first ones have to do more with social studies, which are using multiple perspectives. So the idea that there's not one version of history, there's many versions of history, and we need to make sure we talk about all of them. The other one is using primary sources. So no, your textbook does not know everything that you need to know about history. Let's find the original source, if we can, mm-hmm. and see what they had to say about the experience. So those would be the two that lean more towards specifically history. The other ones were collaboration. So I really tied kind of into what skills do kids need to have for the 21st century. And when you look at the workplace today, it's no longer like sit in your cubicle, head down. It's here's your team, you all need to problem solve together. Mm-hmm. So I did collaboration as a strategy, and I did, of course, technology, because, you know, not only are our kids on it, but that's also a huge part of the workplace. And my final one was academic controversy, which could be used in any classroom. But I think it's really, especially in the events of like the last year, you look at the way people handle any controversial event, and it seems like people have maybe lost the ability to hear the other side.
Girl.
And come to some type of consensus or compromise. So the last one was purposely putting controversial issues into my classroom to teach my kids how to hear both sides and argue on both sides.
Okay. I have a question already. Mm-hmm. Okay, so these umbrellas that you just mentioned, the academic controversy and collaboration technology. Are you developing your own strategies to go under each one of these umbrellas, or are you using research-based stuff that kind of coincides with it?
Both.
Okay.
So what I did is I took my units that I had and I redesigned them to make sure I did at least once a unit each of these strategies. Mm-hmm. And depending on the unit, if I could find something that had the research behind it and said, yes, this is an awesome program, I used that. So for instance, with primary sources for social studies, it's the DBQ project, but they create what's called the mini cues, mm-hmm. and they're fantastic, they're done. So in that case, it was just implementing that in my classroom. I modified it a bit, but it was still theirs. Versus, let's say something for like multiple perspectives. You can't always find every single perspective. So I would go out and find the different perspectives, do my research, and then basically write my own little versions of here's what this group thinks and this group thinks, and give my kids the sources they need to go and find out more. Okay. A little bit.
So when you think back to your teaching style prior to what you're currently doing versus what you're doing now, how has student achievement been impacted?
Oh my goodness, tremendously. Okay, so I started when the EOC was still in place. Mm-hmm. So I definitely came in with the mindset like you gotta drill the EOC, here you go. In a beginning teacher lateral entry, I would say my first 2 years, I was on that test and on that, you know, standard course of study. I wasn't deviating from it much. I still stay with it, or the standard course of study, but my scores in the last year, the growth scores have, I think I went up, I wrote it down. I think I went up almost 2 full points on the index.
Wow.
Yeah, so I went from exceeding high growth to like
really
exceeding high growth.
The
so
highest
just,
growth.
Yeah.
For those of you who are, that's fantastic. For those of you who are just tuning in, you listen to iTEACH, the Target Teachers Radio Show here on BroncoIRadio.com, where every second of the day an artist is live. We are broadcasting from historical Fayetteville State University, and we're talking with Amanda O'Brien, and she's a U.S. history teacher at Terry Sanford, and she's talking about her project with the Governance Teacher Network. And that growth that you have with your kids is phenomenal. So what has been, if you've had this much growth, what has been the feedback from your colleagues? Are they jumping in, and are they having these same experiences by tagging along with some of the things that you're putting into place?
I have been very lucky over the past 3 weeks to do a lot of professional development, mm-hmm. and so far all the teachers, so I was up in Greensboro at the Social Studies Conference, and I've done 2 different professional developments for Cumberland County. And so far, the feedback seems to be very
wow.
receptive to teachers saying, yes, I'm going to try this and implement. Now, granted, I'm in the high school setting, but I've also been presenting to middle school teachers, and they, too, have been receptive with, you know, I have to modify it a little bit, but, you know, so I'm very, in fact, one of the questions you and I were both given was, if this program happened in the future, what would you do next?
Mm-hmm.
And so I would love to next year be able to see what it takes to help another teacher transform their classroom, mm-hmm. because it was a lot of work. It definitely took a lot of time to change everything about how I taught. I wouldn't go back and ever.
So your courses, I'm sorry, Dia. All right, so your courses are semester long or year long?
Semester long.
So you get to do this whole thing twice a year. Do you feel like this semester you found your groove because you've already gone through it one time? Like, have you already tweaked it for this second semester?
Well, yes and no. So the history, we're kind of in an awkward boat this year. We were United States history this year. We changed curriculums to American history this fall. So I originally started this with my U.S. history class, and then, so to answer your question, yes, in the fall I felt like, okay, I'd have already done this once because mm-hmm. I did it with my U.S. history kids, but now this second semester, with my second semester with American history, I've really been able to kind of adjust because,
right.
you know, we're all teachers, you have to adjust.
Gotcha.
Have to be flexible.
What's the feedback you've gotten from your kids? What do they say when they're going through all this? Do they whine and complain about the work, or is there a lot of work? Or how does this go?
My kids definitely work all day. I think, so one of the questions, I did entrance and exit surveys mm-hmm. on the environment of my classroom, and one of the questions I gave them the statement, history is boring. Agree, disagree, and gave them a scale they got to pick. And for both my standard and my honors kids, at the beginning of the school year, overwhelmingly, just about everybody agreed with the statement, history is boring, versus my stats at the end of the semester were almost completely the opposite, history is not boring. And the other ones that were interesting to me is I put statements on there like, I like to write, I like to read, because when you look at the research about engagement, they talk about the entire classroom environment. It's not just the content, it's lots of things going on.
Mm-hmm.
And even statements like, I like to write, increased. Because when you're using, I call them authentic instructional strategies, there's a lot of writing, there's a lot of discourse, there's lots of communication, there's lots of writing. And so I was pleased to see something even like writing, that most kids are like, I don't want to write, you know. They seem to have a positive change in that attitude as well.
I think your project definitely showcases that there is that correlation between cognitive engagement and emotional engagement. I mean, part of it is because she has such a great personality, the way that she presents it. I mean, I've been in one of your sessions, Teach Like a Champion, and I was sitting there, and I'm a champion teacher, but I was inspired even by listening to her. So there's that connection between the cognitive and the emotional.
Mm-hmm. And
how are you going to help teachers get that emotional part in place?
Well, I think part of it is how you help your kids connect to the material, at least in history. I did surveys of my kids for the different strategies to see what they like best. And both standard and honors kids, the multiple narratives, the multiple perspectives was very high because we teach a diverse group of kids. And again, there can't be just this is the one and only one way to look at this. We have to look at it from different perspectives. So I think that really helped my kids feel more of an emotional connection to the material, which kind of gave us maybe some common ground that I, as their teacher, could connect with them on if they could connect with the material. So that definitely helped about, you know, being willing to go outside the box just a little bit.
And that's, I think, high school kids. They're like, they care what other people think. They don't want to hear it just from one point of view.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a good connect to give other perspectives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amanda, I was curious, because you're definitely a natural on the radio, just letting you know. You said you presented. So was this your first time presenting at the conference and for the county, or have you done that in the past?
So professional development in general, over the last 2 years, I've taught a variety of different professional development sessions. The first time I did this one was for the county, and then I did it at the state conference, and then I did it again at our last PD session a couple weeks ago.
Okay.
And what do you get out of that? Because there's a difference between presenting and teaching your classroom. What do you get out of being a professional development facilitator?
It depends on the group. If you're with beginning teachers, I get energized. That is like my kind of restart button. I love beginning teachers. They're so excited, and it's fun to feel that energy again. So I definitely get that from them. From your more veteran teachers, a lot of times I get great ideas myself. You know, there's so many teachers, maybe they aren't doing all of this, but they're doing some of it. And they're generally the ones who are doing these things are eager to share. And in a PD environment, if they can share, if they're a middle school teacher, or maybe they teach world history or civics and economics, if they can share their experiences, then it helps, you know, more people actually find what I'm presenting beneficial to them, or makes it more likely to admit that they might implement it.
Mm-hmm. Amanda, do you present at new teacher orientation? Because I'm looking at you, and that's why I smiled. And I was like, I think I know her. I do know her. I presented across the hall from you. You may not remember, but I love teaching, you know, facilitating professional development for new teachers. And that's something I do look forward to all summer. Like, I can't wait till we go back to school. I get to meet who's coming into the county. I love doing it.
It is. It's something really special about that, because they really have that energy and they have that excitement. It's very natural. And her sessions for new teacher orientation specifically are always very jam-packed. Mm-hmm. And people have
to be
turned away.
The line is down the hall.
Y'all want to know what happened last year? People had to be turned away, and I wanted to go in there, so I kind of just played the model card. And I went on, and some of them like, how in the world are you going? I'm like, you got to know somebody.
Amanda, at the end of a school year, when you turn that light off and the schools are empty, what stands out in your mind as far as using these strategies to engage students? Your highlight, like, what is something that you know, sometimes we have a smile and it warms us. What is that one bulb that came on for a student using these strategies?
I'd say usually it's after the fact. Like, I had them fall semester, and then spring semester, they'll be like, oh, I heard such and such in English, because a lot of times we kind of have overlap, and they're like, and I knew exactly what they were talking about, and I was able to say, you know. And so it's usually when they make some type of connection, or even with, you know, we have so much history around us, when they'll come in and be like, guess what I found out, you know, or guess what I saw in, you know, there's a blog going on right now about Sherman's March. Did you know there's a blog about Sherman?
And
yeah, that's awesome.
Those are the conversations that we want to hear.
Yeah.
We want them to make connections across content and for life.
Yeah.
So that's great. That's great to hear that.
I've got a question for you, Amanda. Do you anticipate that you'll stay in the classroom for the duration of your career, or do you have other aspirations? Because when I look at her and I'm listening, she's one of those people who should be in the classroom forever because the kids benefit, but they always get pulled away and have other assignments.
In my dream world, mm-hmm. I would work pretty much with beginning teachers. So, no, I don't see myself always in the classroom. I would like to go into a position where I can coach teachers on how to teach.
Spread the love.
We'll see.
I'm giving you a high five.
Administration is in the future.
But not administration like assistant principal. No, I'm thinking more like
a curriculum coach.
Maybe.
Like a math coach over there.
I was just going to say, be careful. Never say never. So I'm an instructional coach now. I did it because I wanted to help teachers.
Yep.
I love doing beginning teacher over July. And now I'm thinking, time to be a principal and administrator. So
We had that conversation, didn't we, Dia?
Yes, we did.
Want to be a helper of teachers, a teacher of teachers. No, I want you to teach the children math. Don't leave. Yeah, so when you're great at what you do in the classroom, it comes out and the kids see and the kids benefit it. And unfortunately, or fortunately, however you want to look at it, we lose our great teachers to administration because they have that desire. Because I know we all work with educators that we look and go, I got something to help that, but where is it my place to say something to you?
Mm-hmm.
That's the principal's job or the assistant principal's job. I'm just going to close my door and do my thing. And I think that's so many times where in education, and I think we're getting better at that every year, and it seems such a big push to be collaborative in professional learning communities. But still, at the end of the day, it's your name beside those kids on the report card and on the test. And you know, you want to do the very best, and sometimes you want to do better. It's competitive, too, you know.
Yeah.
People want to, she must be really good. Look at her test scores, all that growth.
I think that's the track that we're on. You know, is to teach. We were talking about teaching men to fish last time we had a radio blog. So to aspire to want to help more people. I mean, the classroom is a great foundation to start with. And it seems like a classroom can't hold you. I feel that personality all the way over here. And I'm not even a social studies, but you got me excited. Like, I want to come to your classroom.
You're engaged.
Like, right
see
now.
What's going
yeah.
on.
You're
so,
engaged.
I mean, that's a great track to be on. And I think as educators, you know, start in a classroom and give what you have and then go on to teach teachers to have what you have to share with others. So
but
that's great.
Speaking of sharing with others, Marlo also had the opportunity this past weekend he presented at them. I think everybody was doing
at ECU.
Yeah, and he was at Central?
Central. Mm-hmm.
Right, and so why don't you tell us about your math conference?
I actually had a great math conference. I saw Ms. Kaysen. We had a great conversation about Dia. That was on Dia's cooperating teacher when she was a student teacher. But I was in
Who will be attending?
But it was a great conference. But what was really surprising, I had a lot of stuff. I was doing the Absolute Value of Might, which is a math-based novel that I really love, and I'm sharing with. And the teachers are really, really receptive. So check TarHillTeachers.blogspot.com because there's going to be more information about the conference. But what was really interesting and got me the most excited, as I was taking all my stuff out, this gentleman said, "Didn't you send out a video?" And I said, "I did." And he said, "Oh, I saw it. I work with German Public Schools." So the word is starting to get out around the state about the program, and so I'm really excited about that. But the conference was very, very well received, and I just had a great time and great energy. So it went well. So how was ECU? You were at a media center conference.
Yes. Pamela Sands, who is the media coordinator for the state, and I, we collaborated to do a PD at ECU for librarians. It was their 10th annual Librarian to Librarian Summit, and we talked about teacher and librarian collaboration within a school and how that could help students as far as achievement level. And I also put the word out about the radio show and the TV show and the blog, and we got awesome feedback. And that was my first time at ECU, and that's my husband's alma mater, but I had never been.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in the library. He didn't even tell me he used to work in the library.
How did
I didn't
you find
know
that,
that
out?
He asked me, where did you present? And I said, in the library. I used to work there. And then we talked about changes, but that's neither here nor there. That was a different realm for me because I'm used to presenting to new teachers or lateral entry or just English language arts. And so to see their perspective on teachers was amazing. They don't feel, and if I'm speaking for you librarians who are listening, you know.
Right into the show. Media coordinators. Yes.
They don't feel like teachers want to collaborate with them. They feel like teachers just want to bring their kids and drop them off so they can then go run copies or meet with parents. But they don't feel like a true collaboration
collaborative environment within their schools, and that's basically what we were talking about. What about in your school? Do you think your media coordinator shares the same feelings?
Well, I was just going to chime in on the collaboration part. I think education in general has a lot to learn from maybe some of the changes that are happening in the business world now. Mm-hmm. That, again, kind of going back to nobody's an individual anymore. Everybody's on a team. And so I feel like maybe even logistically within schools, there should be more facilitation. You know, I know the professional learning communities have been kind of pushed the last couple of years, but I don't know if they're always being utilized like they should. I feel like if more opportunities were given to coordinate with not just other teachers, but with media coordinators mm-hmm. and some of the other different resources within the school, teachers would actually probably have an easier time, because when you're on a team, it's, you know, it's easier than when you're trying to mm-hmm. to push through by yourself.
And you're so right, because I'm just thinking about, okay, so we have Cassandra, who works with the EC population. I'm an AIG consultant. We are supposed to be the go-to person for differentiation within our building, but it's not often that teachers come to me. Like, I feel like I'm going to them with ideas a lot of time. Do you feel that same way? Like, that you have to initiate it, Cassandra?
Yes. We have a new media coordinator, and she's from the islands, but she came here with such great ideas. And I feel like that is the nucleus of the school. If we can, and we have a great resource right there. Mm-hmm. So there's the reading. That's what we need. So if we could pair and promote the media center, you mm-hmm. know, like, I've never heard of what you're doing, but I think that's great. And I would like to see more of the partnering. Like, it's right there, but they'll go around all the way around the media center.
I think it's more so about time. People feel like they don't have enough time to have those conversations.
But that she's a resource, Mom. That's what she's there for.
But what we have done is we actually put documents together that will help you collaborate within your building. Pre-planning forms, collaborative brainstorming, that will... I'm gonna give it to you to put on the blog.
I about to say, where can they find it?
I do operate a blog separate from Tar Heel Teachers. It's teamsmallsworld.blogspot.com. But I will give Marlo the link he already has, but also give him the documents to share out with people, because this can be used for any, it doesn't have to be just for your librarian. It could be teacher to teacher, mm-hmm. librarian to AIG consultant, teacher to EC math coach. It's for anybody.
That's good. Well, I tell you, we've got a couple of things that we want to share. Great conversations. Last time when we had our Focal Friday, we talked about 15 things every teacher needs from a principal. Mm-hmm. And there's a couple more that we want to highlight. This is such a great list, and we're going to post it on the blog. One thing that we want to highlight is teachers need to feel that their principals are fair and will not show favoritism to an individual or group. So we don't want them to think that the media coordinator is their favorite, or the EC coach is their favorite, or math coach. So is that a true statement? I think that's just natural. You want to be treated fairly.
Yeah, that's one of the things when I was reading the article that I broke down first. And I put, it really has to do with transparency and trust, because when you feel like there are special circumstances that so-and-so has this and so-and-so has this, it just kind of, as a teacher, puts you at ease. Like, well, what do I trust? You know, I don't mm-hmm. know. It just seems like there's, when, if the favoritism is shown, mm-hmm. that something might
not. I understand. I do understand, because it's like, if favoritism is shown, then when a need arises for you and a decision is made, you're then thinking, well, did they make that because they're being fair, or did they say that because they're trying to look out for somebody else?
Well, I think we should give praise for the things that teachers do, but I think there are some teachers that are like behind the curtain people. Mm-hmm. They do great things and it matters, but because it doesn't fit into that box of what, you know, maybe we deem important, then sometimes we don't recognize them. So mm-hmm. I think just like our students, we have to find that one thing about them that is, you know, good and knowledgeable.
You know, it goes back to how teachers have to deal with students differently. Administrators have to deal with teachers differently.
Mm-hmm.
You may have somebody who is more high profile in the building, and
right.
they just thrive on doing all these different school-wide projects, and somebody else might like to sit back and work behind the scenes. And both ways and methods are okay, as long as everybody is working to the best of their ability,
right.
And administrators just have to handle them differently.
And then what you're dealing with is the perception of the staff. Mm. And so that, coming from an administrator, I know what's going on because I'm the one that's right in the middle of it. But then you've got certain staff that see what you're doing with that particular person or that particular group, and maybe they take it the wrong way, they see it the wrong way, and that's the farthest from what we're doing. I'm working with them because of this kind of thing that's going on, not because I like you better than I like somebody else over here. Sometimes it's a perception thing, which becomes their reality. So you really, as the principal, have to be visible, vocal, and vigilant with your whole staff and be available for everybody all the time, so that there's not this thought, well, the only time I can see him is get on his calendar or whatever. But you seem like you just walk in and get in and talk to him anytime.
Marlos,
yes.
You have to know somebody.
You got to
know somebody.
Well, that's one thing that I know, that up next we're going to have our positive quote of the day. It's iTEACH, the Tahoe Teachers Radio Show, right here on BroncoArtRadio.com, where every second of the day an artist is live. So much fun.
This is BroncoEyeRadio.com, where every second of the day an artist is live, and home of the second annual I Inspire Showcase Concert featuring the 39th anniversary celebration of the FSU Gospel Choir on February 28th at 6 p.m. in the Seabrook Auditorium. You are listening to iTEACH. Take it away, Marlo.
Are you all happy I didn't interrupt her?
Good job.
Or cut her off. I'm growing. I'm engaged. Okay, so we want to leave you all with a positive thought before we leave. You've got about 2 or 3 minutes to wrap the show up. Okay, so our quote for today is, great leaders don't set out to be a leader. They set out to make a difference. It's never about the role, always about the goal. Mm-hmm. I love that, because I believe that you have to be faithful over the few things, and then he'll make you ruler over many. So even if your role was being in the office, you're still making a difference, even as working as an office personnel or working the cafeteria, custodian, all the way to teacher, administrator. Everybody has a role that they can play, and you can be a leader in the life of a child.
Amen.
I second it.
No one ever said it.
What more can you say? I mean, I think a leader, you don't always know. Sometimes you don't always know that you're a leader, and I have to point that out to teachers all the time. Mm-hmm. You're a leader in your classroom, and you're making a difference every day. And I almost kind of read into that. Sometimes we don't even realize we're making the difference. We don't even realize how we've impacted students' lives. And sometimes you lose sight of the forest because of that tree that's got right in your way. And you just, until that child comes back around and sees you and says, you know, I loved your class so much, or you're the greatest teacher, or you're the greatest principal, or whatever, and you're just like, oh, that's why we do it. Not for the accolades like that, but you get that, and I just like, wow, I really am making a difference. I thank you. Okay, you just made my day.
I will say this about what you just said. You don't realize. I think I just cut Dia off again.
Wow. Dia said 5 words to
you off, and then you
cut her
off. Dia closed.
Go ahead, Dia.
I was just going to say, speed talk, I was just going to say, when you're making a difference, other people want to make a difference like you, so then you're ending up being a leader because you're sharing how you make a difference.
Oh,
good.
That's
good. 2 seconds of talk. Yeah.
Everybody, so much for tuning into our show today. This was such a great show and a great way to end our week. We want to thank our guest, Amanda O'Brien, for joining us here in the studio, and best of luck as you finish up your GTM project.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much. And we always have a great time with our administrative designee. We can't wait till next month when you'll come back.
I'll be back.
We'll do it all over
again.
Have some more fun. And we hope everybody else will join us next week as we have the same conversation. iTEACH, the Tahoe Teachers Radio Show, 5 p.m. until 6 p.m. only on BroncoOurRadio.com, where every second of the day
an artist is live.
Have a great weekend, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.